Mountain Bike National Series race number one.
Number one, round one. Main goal, don't crash.
No, that's not the main goal, really.
Well, it's
one of the goals. Crash is part of mountain bike racing.
It's the equivalent of kicking your car tyres, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, all feels good. Oh yes, it feels right.
Yeah, absolutely feels good. All pressure is just right. No. Lauren won't end up the way up a little Lego man is upside down, but you never know.
You alright there, Tom?
Yeah, 5 weeks in Lanzarote. This time yesterday, well, just before this time, about 24 hours ago, I was getting out of the sea and it was like high 20s, boiling hot, almost too hot to get your wetsuit on and off. And now, look.
But
it's cold, it's wet. It's very muddy. That's why I don't do mountain bike racing. Okay, so here we go. Lauren must be like literally the brownest person here as well.
Which?
We're going, it's so muddy, we're going spray trousers for the warm-up, I think. Is that right?
Yeah.
And maybe probably winter shoes, so I'll keep the feet dry for the warm-up.
Yeah, winter shoes, yeah.
And then, and winter top as well, I think,
yeah,
and gloves. But then it's all coming off. Yeah. And then it's all coming off for the race start.
Yeah.
I'm not in my new camo kit because we were anticipating the weather being this cold when we were going to wear it. So I'm in like dry robe at the lot, basically. Here we go.
Cool.
Right then.
Right.
Cool. Here we go. Again. Practice lap time. Okay, so it's just started raining a bit, which means I now look like Bruce Willis from Unbreakable. I definitely don't feel unbreakable. Lauren's still on her warm-up lap. It's not going to rain anymore, because if it does, it's going to be a bit interesting. And it's already pretty tricky conditions, but more concerned about getting soaked watching. But don't tell Lauren that. 15, 20 minutes and counting till the start. And I'm also going to try and do something, set myself some goals for this afternoon. I'm going to try and break the world record for the number of hot chocolates drunk in 1 hour. Okay, so here she comes, back from a practice lap. Go on then.
Oh, you only got about a third of the way round.
Oh.
And I was like, looking at the time, I said to him, how far in am I? And he was like, only about a third of the lap. I was like, fuck. So, slow.
Slow,
really,
is it?
Is it? Really slow, really tricky, because it's just thick mud the entire way. So not like there's just sections of it. And bear in mind, I was going slowly, so I missed maybe going really slowly. And on my own, like no one spraying me. So, but
nothing worse than being sprayed, is there, with something you don't want?
This bit is by far.
Yeah, I know. Like, I just realised, I just sent a couple of guys a video to say, like, this is the driest area and it's minging.
And not just by a little bit, by a million miles. It's just thick sludge mud the entire way. So, yes.
Okay.
Tricky, really tricky.
Right then. Game on then. Should be fun.
It will be an experience, that's for
sure. So I'm going to have time to get hot chocolate in laps, aren't I?
I'd say so.
Get low when the whistle goes. like a pretty cool course, to be honest with you. I can't say I'd really enjoy these conditions. Not because I don't mind the technicality, but just talking about getting fucking wet and cold. Yeah, they've gone. This here, some of the courses like this, I'm just going to go and dump a couple of things in the van, try and come back down and see what she's up to. It's going to be a fun day no matter what. She has finished. Probably not the race she wanted, but very, very gutsy performance in brutal conditions, as you can see, and a lot of learning. How was it?
Bloody hell. You cannot. Oh, that was.
A lot of learning.
A lot of learning. Probably one of those mentally challenging things I've ever done in my life.
I think that's the least I've ever seen you smile.
Yeah. Well, it took every ounce of energy not to pull out and can it after lap one.
Yeah.
Oh, fucking hell.
But you actually seem to get better a little bit in places.
A little, but you get a bit more used to the mud. But of course, I probably do a bit too much fair weather riding, so I don't ride in the mud. At all, so I got a little bit more used to it, but also got more and more tired as well.
Well, lots of experience.
Lots of learning, and the goal just switched to just finish because I saw a lot of people crash, a lot of people in mechanicals, and a couple of girls pull out and just bin it. So I think, well, if I just finish, then
gained a lot.
Yeah.
Okay, you fucked up my nice kit design, but there we go. Look at it. It's a pretty muddy day.
Brown polka dot.
Okay, time for me to wash the bike, right?
Ah, dirty. Filthy. Nasty. Yeah. Too dirty to clean my act up. Yeah. If you ain't dirty, you ain't here to party.
Come here, your mum did this for you when you were little and you didn't know.
It's so rough though.
Mandy will be happy with you.
You're wiping my face. A lot of dirt. It was all worth it for a coffee and a cake.
So here we go. I thought I'd give you a bit of a debrief from my race. Now it's been about a week gone and I've reflected a little bit on the race, and I thought I would just give a bit of an honest debrief and review of the day, of the event, and what I thought, what I took from it, and probably more than anything, what I learned and what I would do differently next time. So just clear, open honesty, because I think, you know, the reality is, unless I'm totally honest, I'm not going to make changes and improvements from now until next time. There is a round two in a couple of weeks, and I need to think about how I would approach that differently if I go and do that. So what would I do differently? Number one is I'd make sure I'm better prepared and give myself sufficient time for the practice laps. I underestimated that, partly because of the conditions, but obviously every course is a little bit different as well. I underestimated how long that practice lap would take. I didn't give myself sufficient enough time to be able to go round the whole loop. So I actually ended up starting the race with about half the course blind. I hadn't seen it before. And that was a real rookie error. And that was really stupid, a really stupid mistake for me to make, and a really unprofessional one. Actually, in hindsight, what I chat to some of the other girls that do a little bit more regularly and race at a more elite and professional level is they actually go up the day before and they go and do the practice laps the day before and on the day. So they actually give themselves several opportunities to go and practice at the lap. So they're really tuned in. They've taken several different lines. They work out, you know, which lines are the most effective. What technical sections are worth doing, the A line, the B line, etc. And I just didn't do that. So Number one is to give myself more time, go and do not just one full practice lap, but potentially multiple practice laps. So that was the first thing that I did. The second was to know the course better. Again, see, this ties in with point number one. If I'd done more practice laps, I'd know the course better. So that I obviously was better prepared for myself, but also for my spectators as well, for Tom. I would be able to give him a little bit more info about where to stand, where to watch, and be able to support me better. You know, I wasn't 100% clear. I was a little bit confused where the start line was. It didn't, you know, cause me any issues in the end, because I found it in plenty of time. But obviously not being totally clear where that was a bit of a mistake as well, and was poor on my part. I also recognise that I probably rely on Tom and his support in the racing and prepping my mountain bike a little bit too much. I thought I'd done a pretty good job, but actually when I arrived, I realised there was a couple of little things that I'd forgotten, and realised that I probably rely on Tom's help and support on that too much, and I need to be way more independent in that respect. And actually, that probably leads to a wider piece. And I really hate to say this and admit it, but I think the reality was, and actually looking around the rest of the event, I was really ashamed actually to see that quite a lot of the girls there were relying on their kind of male partners, friends, etc., to help them with quite a bit of the bike maintenance, bike cleaning, things like that. And myself included. Obviously you've seen in the video, Tom cleaned my bike for me after. Now that's fine if it's just a matter of, actually, do you know what, you're helping out, but do we rely on the men to do a little bit too much of that for us? And, you know, sadly, I think the answer is yes. And I really want to change that. And I really want to be totally more independent, and I don't need Tom's help on any of my bike maintenance, any of my bike setup, those bits and pieces. So that's a big goal for me next time as well, to be totally self-sufficient in that respect. And if I'm asking for his help, it is just purely from a time perspective rather than a skill perspective. So that's certainly a big goal for me, and hopefully I can help to kind of lead the way and role model that for some others too. My next point was, I definitely allowed my head to go a little bit. I let my head sort of, I psyched myself out a little bit on a couple of the sections. I skidded, lost control, and I let that psych me out. I let myself think the course was too hard for me, and it wasn't. I could have attacked the course better if I'd kept my nerve and kept my head straight, and I allowed myself to get a little bit more psyched out than I normally would, because actually I would say that this is something that I wouldn't normally experience, but I probably allowed myself to become a little bit overwhelmed by the situation. And instead of controlling the controllables, making sure I stayed in control of my emotions, I let them run wild, and that ended up having a negative effect on my race. And particularly the riding conditions, obviously I allowed them to do that, but part of that was in my control too. I've probably been way too much of a fair weather rider. I've been out, you know, loving and enjoying mountain biking, but if it's raining and it's muddy, I don't tend to go out. But the reality is, if I want to race and I want to be competitive, then I'm going to have to suck that up a bit, and I'm going to have to get out in those conditions and go and practice in that. So I've got some really clear areas that I can improve on for next time and work on to become more competitive, to be able to go and attack the course, but more than anything else, so that I can enjoy it more. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm absolutely on this journey for fun and enjoyment above anything else. And those of you that know me will know that that is my number one priority. And that's the thing that's more important to me than anything else. But being well prepared and taking it more seriously will allow me to enjoy it more. So I think that's something that some of us sometimes get wrong. We want the primary objective to be thoroughly enjoying it, but actually we have to take it seriously enough to be able to get the most out of it and to be able to enjoy it. So I guess the message to myself and to some others out there as well is, don't be afraid to take it seriously enough to really get the most out of it. I think, like I say, sometimes we get those two things confused, and that would be my biggest tip. So I've got some clear learning points. Going and doing the race absolutely was valuable for those points alone, to learn those things that I don't think I would have learned had I not gone and done that event. But I also understand that those things are going to mean nothing if I don't do anything with them. So stay tuned. Round two is in a few weeks' time. Let's see what I can change between now and then. Keep following to find out what happens.